Chemistry made me crazy as a student because it seemed like a thrown together subject. Just a grab bag of random, unrelated topics. Even after teaching chemistry for many years, in some ways I still feel that way. If you page through a chemistry textbook, it jumps around from the composition of compounds, elements, atoms, ions, physical properties, chemical properties, types of reactions, energy changes. It seems like in chemistry, we study just everything anyone has ever figured out about how matter behaves. It's not nicely organized like math or physics or biology. I never got the sense of you start with this fundamental thing, and then this follows, and then this next thing. This feeling was exacerbated by my freshman year chemistry class in college at Caltech. We didn't have a textbook. We had several professors that year just come in and talk about what they thought was important in chemistry. Don't get me wrong, I learned a lot, but it didn't help me develop a sense of how the subject was organized or could be organized. I had no idea what subject was coming next, no idea how the topics could be connected to each other. Because the subject is so disorganized, you would think that means chemistry is a young science, but no, that's not true. That's not the reason. People have been studying chemistry ever since the cavemen mixed together pigments to do their cave paintings. The Iron Age and the Bronze Age, we actually named entire historical periods after advances in metallurgy. How long ago do you think gunpowder was invented? The alchemists are probably the closest to what we would recognize as early chemists. There were the ancient Greeks with their four elements of nature, earth, air, fire, and water. And they combined their philosophy with the Egyptians and their mystical rituals about rebirth, associated with the Nile River and its rich black soil they called Chem. The Greeks called Egypt Chemia. Then in the 7th century, Egypt was occupied by Arabs and they added Al to form the word Alchemia, the Black Land. Alchemy was introduced to the West in the 8th century when the Arabs brought it to Spain, and eventually it spread as far as India and China. Sadly, we've lost most of the earliest alchemy texts because in the year 391, the Great Library at Alexandria burned. But we do have some very interesting writings about alchemy from the Middle Ages. Those alchemists got kind of a bad rap as a bunch of kooks. I don't think we should sneer at their efforts because they weren't scientists exactly. They were sort of like pre-scientists. Alchemists wanted to harness the power of nature and create the legendary Philosopher's Stone that would grant them eternal life. They also wanted to use the Philosopher's Stone to generate gold and other precious materials out of less valuable base matter like lead. They were pursuing transmutation. They thought that substances could evolve or develop towards a more perfect state. That's the result of observing physical and chemical changes. And that's where you start to do chemistry. The alchemists were doing their best to catalog their observations about how different kinds of matter interacted. And that's a scientific impulse. They just weren't very systematic about it. And they had a warped sense of logic because mysticism was intertwined in everything they did. If the alchemists observed something they didn't understand, they made up a rule to explain it. And these rules seem superstitious to us now. They almost gave personalities to the different metals they worked with. And they thought that a celestial object, as well as a day of the week and an organ in the human body, was connected to each element. So, for instance, lead was connected to Saturn and Saturday, and in your body, the spleen. Eventually, the work of early scientists, or natural philosophers, that's what they were called in the 17th, 18th centuries, they accumulated enough reproducible information that scholars concluded the aims of alchemy were just not reasonable. So maybe we should say chemistry, as we know it, based on experimental evidence, started around the 18th, 19th century. So, can we start there and describe what chemistry is? Maybe in terms of other subjects we do have a better handle on. Before I go on, I want to encourage you to sign up for our Chemistry Club mailing list. Here at Socratica, we're building a series of chemistry videos to help you learn more. For each video, there's a free short quiz. And if you want longer practice tests, those are available for purchase on Socratica.com. When you sign up for our tastefully infrequent emails, you'll get notified when there are new releases. Now, back to unraveling this hairy problem of what is chemistry. Chemistry is often called the central science because it connects to so many other disciplines. You can picture it sitting in the middle, like a giant hub of science knowledge. You have physics over there, and physical chemistry. Biology has biochemistry. Here's geology and geochemistry. Astronomy, astrochemistry. If you want to study these disciplines, biology, geology, astronomy, material science, the truth is, you won't get very far into the nitty-gritty unless you know some chemistry. Of course, you can learn some basics, but you're fooling yourself if you think you'll have access to the whole field. Chemistry is what gives you a more complete understanding, and it's through a chemical understanding that you'll be able to talk with real biologists, real astronomers, and not just read a textbook written for beginners. Back when I was teaching, I got in this huge argument with a micromanaging administrator who tried to tell me it made no difference whether a student had the prerequisite of chemistry before they took my advanced biology class. I flatly refused to accept any students into my class who hadn't studied any chemistry, because guess what? At least a third of my class was chemistry. Biochemistry is about the subset of chemicals found in living organisms. Molecular biology is about molecules. How can you teach any real significant biology to someone who doesn't know what molecules are and how they behave chemically? It would be like saying you can take calculus before you take algebra. I'm still mad. I won, obviously, but I'm still mad that someone could be that dismissive of how important chemistry is. You see, in many ways, the study of biology is an extension of the study of chemistry. All of life, every bit of our bodies, is made up of chemical compounds. This is true of all living things. Those chemicals interact with each other, sticking together to make larger compounds, or breaking apart to make smaller modules that can be reused or exchanged for energy. All the essential biological processes, cell reproduction, glycolysis, cellular respiration, photosynthesis, these are all built up from a set of chemical reactions and exchanges of chemical energy. If you don't understand the chemistry of biological molecules, in plants and animals, you won't understand how these organisms reproduce, develop, grow. You won't understand diet or nutrition or hormone signaling, how we taste and smell and see, or how animals are able to move by contracting their muscles, or how the neurons in your brain function. So, even if you consider yourself a biologist, or you want to major in biology, or medicine for that matter, you're not going to get very far unless you get a strong background in chemistry. I personally am a molecular biologist, and so this was a big leveling up step for me, to respect what I had to learn from chemistry before I could move forward in my chosen field. Now, let's talk a little bit about how chemistry is relevant in other subjects you might be interested in. When kids are first interested in astronomy, we give them a telescope, which is a lot of fun. But most modern astronomy isn't about looking through a telescope with your naked eye. There's a fundamental connection between chemistry and astronomy, and it includes how elements are generated in fiery stars, or, on the other side of the story, how molecular clouds could give rise to stars. You'll hear a lot about spectral lines in astronomy. Every element and molecule emits light at specific frequencies, so we can use chemical spectrographs to identify the composition of stars and other celestial objects. Geology is another field that is basically chemistry at its heart. Rocks and minerals are chemicals, so you see geologists using a lot of the tools of chemistry in their work. They have to examine the chemical composition of samples in order to understand hardness and erosion. There are gradual chemical changes as rocks and minerals interact with the environment and break down over time. The study of radioactive elements is essential for dating, like carbon dating. Engineering is probably the most blue sky area for extensions of chemistry. Engineering is all about using science and math to solve problems, and we never run out of problems. A big area of research right now is energy. Can we conserve energy or produce more energy? Can we do a better job capturing solar energy? And can we make more efficient batteries for storing energy? Chemists will help solve those problems. A lot of engineering depends on how well you understand the materials you have to work with. What kind of stress can they withstand? Are they going to break down when they come in contact with a cleaning solution? Is it safe, chemically inert, or is it volatile? Chemistry lets you understand a material's strength, appearance, whether it's combustible, and so on. And if you're not satisfied with the materials that are out there, you can make new ones by using applied chemistry or chemical engineering. Now, physics is a really interesting case. Physics and chemistry are so interdependent. When I study chemistry, I find myself falling back on a lot of physics concepts to understand why the chemistry works. Why are particles moving this way? What's the force of attraction or repulsion? Why is this form more stable? So, even though we call chemistry the central science, I might argue that it all really starts with physics. You don't need to study all of physics to understand chemistry, but it's a good idea to get familiar with the basic concepts and then circle back later. Similarly, you don't need to study all of chemistry to study physics, but maybe start with atomic structure, and in particular, the behavior of electrons. Here's how I would actually suggest people study the sciences. Physics first, on one level. Basic conceptual physics that doesn't take much math. Then chemistry. Then biology. Then circle back to physics and learn more, including the calculus. Then branch out into astronomy, engineering, material science, whatever tickles your brain. But set yourself up for success by understanding how interrelated all of these disciplines are. Chemistry will help you get there. I think it wasn't until I taught chemistry that I finally got a handle on what we know in the subject and what we're still trying to figure out. Even as an instructor, it's challenging to know what to include in a given class and what to leave out. If you look at different college catalogs, you'll see the chemistry subjects are broken up in different ways. If you ask a chemist, how many branches of chemistry are there? Some say 5, some say 6. I saw one list that said 10. It depends on how you count them. The most common answer I see is 5 branches of chemistry. Organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, physical chemistry, analytical chemistry, and biochemistry. Organic chemistry is the study of chemical compounds that contain carbon. This is really important for understanding life on Earth because all living things have carbon as the backbone of their molecules. So, organic chemists study the structure and properties of all these carbon-based molecules. And there's all kinds of applications in biotechnology, petroleum, plastics. Inorganic chemistry studies the rest of the chemical compounds, everything that's inorganic or non-living. That doesn't mean these kinds of chemists never study anything containing carbon. There's some crossover. Industry applications include things like making fertilizer, creating chemical sunscreens, studying pigments for paint. Physical chemistry is when you use physics to explain chemical phenomena. So think about how we have physics equations to describe how objects move, forces of attraction, wave behavior. New physics emerges when you try to extrapolate to describe the physical behavior of tiny things, like atoms and molecules. And of course, what the physical chemists discover gets incorporated into all the other branches of chemistry, because everyone has to obey the laws of physics. Analytical chemistry is maybe the most quantitative of the chemical disciplines. Take any chemical property and figure out how to measure it and track it and compare it. If you like fiddling with lab equipment like mass spectrometers and bomb calorimeters and chromatographs and titrating, then maybe analytical chemistry is for you. Biochemistry is the study of the molecules of life, and it relies on the same techniques that other chemists use, along with some specialized ways of studying things. For instance, the exact three-dimensional shape of proteins when they're properly folded up, and the dynamics of how they interact with each other, and how enzymes catalyze reactions, things like that. By the way, I made another video, What is Biochemistry?, if you want to learn more about what that field covers. Keep in mind, this separation of five disciplines in chemistry is so arbitrary. You can already see there's a lot of overlap between these five. And then there are a million specialized fields. You can add theoretical chemistry, forensic chemistry, environmental chemistry, nuclear chemistry. I'm glad you've found Socratica, where you can learn more. That's our promise to you. You can do your part by signing up for our Chemistry Club mailing list, so you'll learn about new releases and other goodies we're making for you. Remember, for each video in our series, there's a short quiz. I've also created some longer practice tests, so you can check yourself to see how much have you actually learned. A lot. I'm sure you've learned a lot. You can find those practice tests on Socratica.com. Thanks for watching.